Most Judas Priest fans know the band by this logo, and those familiar with their early work might also remember that one.
Nothing new.
Yet before settling on their most recognizable brand identity, Judas Priest actually went through a couple of very interesting phases and logos you'd never expect them to use. When talking about the logos which appeared on the artworks of the official studio albums by Judas Priest, I hear that the best place to start would be probably at the very beginning. The Judas Priest logo, which appeared on their very first studio album, Rockerola, was rather simplistic. Designed by the Gull Records artist John Pasha, this logo actually became the shortest-lived logo in the Judas Priest career, since even on the later re-releases of their debut record, Judas Priest actually got rid of this version and replaced it with one which appeared on their second studio album, Sad Wings of Destiny. On Sad Wings of Destiny, John Pasha gave the Judas Priest logo a much-needed update, which in my personal opinion perfectly fits the overall mood of both Sad Wings of Destiny and Sin After Sin, on which this logo actually appeared. The Gothic font used in that version perfectly captures the essence of the band in their early days, adding to this mysterious atmosphere created by the artworks on the second and third album, and in reality becomes the first proper logo by Judas Priest. Although, if we're being very honest, this logo idea was actually not original of John Pasha and was used by the band a little bit earlier before that, of which we'll talk in just a moment.
What?
Their fourth studio album, Stained Glass, the CBS artist Roslav Zhaibo decides to completely scrap whatever has been used by the band before him and provide a completely new identity for Judas Priest to better match their updated look and the vigorous sound they've produced on their fourth studio record. You might think that this is the logo that they have used ever since, but they did not actually. Since technically on the follow-up album, Killing Machine, Roslav Zhaibo actually changed this one a bit, added another extra jiggly swiggly thingy under Judas, and shortened the space between Judas and Priest to make the logo more compact and symmetric. And yes, now this is the version which has shaped the Judas Priest identity for years to come. The 1990s were of course a time of change for Judas Priest. With Rob Halford gone, a new vocalist, and their search for new and modern sound, Judas Priest also felt like they needed a new and updated logo for the band. And so for their first ever studio record without Rob Halford on vocals, the legendary artist Mark Wilkinson designs a new, updated, and very 90s looking logo for Judas Priest. For the very first time ever incorporated into the logo, their famous Judas Priest cross, which of course appeared first on Sad Wings of Destiny. By the way, speaking about the Judas Priest cross, if you haven't seen it yet, there is a special episode dedicated to the meaning behind it and what it actually symbolizes, which I believe you can find somewhere over here. And I strongly encourage you to watch after watching this video. So do it.
Exactly.
And of course it is the same logo designed by Mark Wilkinson, although streamlined and slightly updated, which will later on appear on another studio album without Rob Halford on vocals, Demolition. On July 11th in 2003, when Rob Halford reunited with Judas Priest, the band of course went back to their original true form. Instead of simply going back to their classic logo designed by Roslav Zhaibo, Judas Priest once again got a brand new logo for themselves, which of course looks very much like the one used throughout the 1980s, yet with a final T in Priest replaced with the legendary Judas Priest cross. And in addition, once again reduced the amount of swiggly things under the word Judas to 5, like it was on the Stained Glass logo. And yes, it is this logo that Judas Priest has used ever since. With the bare exception of their experimental rock opera album Nostradamus, on which they completely scrapped their logo to better fit the medieval atmosphere produced by that album.
Which, in my opinion, is perfectly fine. Yet, to be honest with you, I'm very curious why didn't the band go with their classic Gothic-style logo for that album cover, since in my personal opinion, it would not only fit the album artwork well, but also create that necessary connection with the band's early work. But yeah, other than that, the band has continued using their updated version of their classic Judas Priest logo.
And in fact, for those who, like myself, refer to this as the new Judas Priest logo, here is a piece of information. As of today, this is actually the longest used Judas Priest logo in their entire career. Ready to fight with no surrender. And so one might have thought that this is it, but it is not. When releasing their first studio album, Rock-A-Rolla, Judas Priest of course also released a single featuring their title track and the song Never Satisfied. And so the original artwork for the German version of that single featured yet another plain text logo by Judas Priest, which although in its idea quite similar to the one appeared on the album Rock-A-Rolla, still is a completely different version from the one known to most people. Yet my personal favorite one out of the awkward logos Judas Priest have ever used is of course the one released on the French 7-inch single, which of course perfectly captures the happy atmosphere of the early 70s and the overall look of Judas Priest in the early days. Well, just in case, I'm being slightly sarcastic here. All of those logos were developed only when Judas Priest were already signed to Gold Records and were about to release their first studio album, Rock-A-Rolla. So what did the band use before that? Remember how I said that the first proper Gothic style Judas Priest logo developed by John Pasha on Sad Wings of Destiny was not really entirely his idea? Well, all the way back in 1972, even before Rob Halford or Glenn Tipton joined Judas Priest in fact did use an early variation of their Gothic style logo while playing at local bars and clubs around Birmingham. And yes, it is this early 1972 version of the Judas Priest Gothic style logo which will become the main inspiration for John Pasha, and yes, it is the first logo that Judas Priest has ever used in their career. And which is your personal favorite Judas Priest logo? Please let us know in the comments. And also, if you're one of those lucky people who will get to see Judas Priest live on their 50 Heavy Metal Years tour, and you'd like to rock some Metal Pilgrim merch for it and support this show and my country, I think you know where to find an order for one. In the pinned comment. Thank you so much for watching this short video, guys, and we will prevail. Slava Ukraini!